Good morning and welcome to the candidate forum for the 25th Congressional District. For those of you who don't know me, my name is John Musella. I'm the incoming chairman of the San Mateo Valley Chamber of Commerce, a member of the Government Affairs Committee, and a 12-year resident of Santa Clarita Valley, and I've lived and worked up here for the last dozen years. Before we begin this morning, I'd ask that we all please stand in a moment of silence in honor of Sergeant Stephen Owen, 29-year veteran of the LA County Sheriff's Department, who was killed this past Wednesday in the line of duty. Thank you. I'd now like to introduce Nancy Starzik with the Southland Regional Association of Realtors.
Thank you. Thank you all for being here. I would like to ask or introduce, first of all, I believe it is Sergeant Lieutenant. Yes, Albert?
Staff Sergeant.
Staff Sergeant Albert Rodriguez. He served in Iraq in the year 2003 for 9 months. He was over there with the first wave, and he spent 12 years as a Marine, and he's going to lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
I'd also like to take a moment to introduce a few dignitaries that are in the room. I understand that Scott Loeb is on his way.
He is on his way.
And in the room we have Bill Cooper, who is the Vice President of Cascade Lake Water Agency, right here in front. And also Jerry Gladbach, who is on the Cascade. There he is over there. Thank you. And we also have Vanessa Will, representing the 21st Senatorial District. And I'm going to spare you all of the chamber and the Southland Regional dignitaries because there's too many of them in the room. So I'd like to just take a moment now and introduce or at least state the names of the sponsors. There are a long list, so I'm going to go through it quickly. First of all, Casey Kirkman from Affordable Clothing, Moving, and Storage. Fred Arnold, American Family Funding. Mike Mina, Augusta Finance. Phil Green, Bank of America Home Loans. Billy Portfield, Camelot Moving and Storage. Dan Caballero, CBA Exterminators. David Randolph, Escrow Advantage, and also Remax Boat. Anita and Jim Lombardi from Federal Escrow. Don Zirkel, First American Home Buyers Protection. Carol Braun, First American Natural Hazard Disclosure. Karen Kosky, Franklin Loan Center. Linda Overton, Glenos Escrow. Carol Smith, Insurance, SCB. Bob Keller and Marty Kovacs, Keller Davis. Betty Wright, Logics. Linda Richardson, Mid-American Mortgage. Jessica Wood, Olfer Public Home Protection. Diane Keefe, Pathway Escrow. Annette McGuire, Pacific Funding. Sherry Springer, Brundage, Pacific Trust Escrow. And I'm turning the page for the last few. Jim and Janice Tanner from Realty Executives. Shannon Gutierrez, Valley Wide Escrow. Brian Borger, Wells Fargo Mortgage. Keith and Jason Reno, Wintrust Mortgage. I'd like to make one request of all of us today. There are cards on the table and pens available for questions. We will be roaming around the room collecting those as the program progresses. Please write legibly for us so that we don't have to rewrite them, okay? And thank you very much. I'm gonna pass this back over to John Musella.
Thanks, Nancy. You're welcome. All right, well, we would of course like to first begin by welcoming our two candidates this morning for U.S. Congress, Congressman Steve Knight and Mr. Brian Caporio. Thank you. As you know, this morning's Congressional Candidate Forum is being presented by the Southland Regional Association of Realtors as well as the Santa Cruz Valley Chamber of Commerce. As we all know, the Santa Cruz Valley is a great place to live, work, and do business here. We all love our valley very much. and is one of the top places to do business in all of LA County and California. Our two organizations have been hosting these forums for several years and have high respect from candidates on both sides of the political aisle for ensuring equitable and equal treatment on the issues that are facing our region. Both candidates this morning have already been informed about this morning's forum, but let me share a few details with you so we're all on the same page. Each candidate is going to be given 5 minutes for their opening statements. Following opening statements, we will go to 5 prepared questions that have been shared with the candidates in advance regarding real estate and business issues facing the Valley and the nation. Each candidate is going to have 3 minutes to respond. If a candidate specifically raises an issue with his opponent in their response, the opponent will be given 1 minute for rebuttal. We'll then move to questions from the audience and in the allotted time, the end of the forum. Questions from the audience must be policy and or issue related, and any questions deemed to be an attack on a specific candidate are going to be skipped. So as Nancy mentioned, you have cards on the table. Please fill them out legibly. I have terrible handwriting, so I personally would probably have someone else do it for me. But please write legibly, and if someone else is going to sort through the questions, I'll read them for everyone. We also have a timer here at the back table. Peter, could you raise your hand? Peter is going to give a 1 minute warning, 30-second warning, and then a stop sign when time is up. And I think that is about it. We're going to alternate, obviously, between the candidates on their questions. And with that, we're going to begin. We would now like to offer the first opening statement to Congressman Steve Knight.
Good morning, Assemblyman.
I've never seen it set up this way ever.
Well, good morning, all. Thank you to the chamber. Thank you to the Southland Realtors. It's an honor to be here. It really is. And I think that these are very, very important. You get to see what we talk about, what the issues are, maybe the differences, maybe some of the similarities. I honestly believe that we have more similarities than we have differences in a community, no matter how you believe and what party you're part of. So I'll give you just a brief rundown, but we're in the middle of our debates right now, and I think that we have gone through our intros so many times that many of us have seen these intros so much that I'm going to change mine up dramatically. But I do have my beautiful wife here, Lily, years on October 28th, just to remind you, golf club would be okay. We do have two beautiful boys. One's living in Chicago, and his first big boy job just graduated Cal State Sacramento, and one goes to Arizona State and has a Sun Devil out there. So we're very proud of our boys and everything that they have done and continue to do. But I wanted to talk about what we talked about last time when we were running. There was 8 of us up here, and we talked about what is the most important thing for the country, what's the most important thing for Santa Clarita. And if you remember, all 8 of us talked about the CMEX mine and the possibility of mining happening there. That has remained our top priority. Now, things don't happen overnight, as we know here in Santa Clarita. This has been going on for 18 years. But in the first 8 months of my session, we did get the contracts to be nullified. So that's a 180-degree turn from anything that's ever happened in CMEX. There is no mining over there, and they cannot mine. They are going through the appeals process. We do live in America, and I know that some people on Facebook like to say, well, it's not over. Well, that's right. We do have an appeals process, but that's moving through the process. So that remains to be our top local priority. But we talked about a lot of other things that happened in that debate and have happened over years. Anybody knows what's happened at Bokeh Canyon? Every year that we have a good rain, that road gets washed out. Thankfully, Supervisor Antonovich just fixed it. Supervisor Antonovich just came in here, gave a little money to the fixing of the road, and the road got fixed. Well, this last year we found out that there's a stickleback fish there and there's some other problems. And so we have to go through all of these changes so that we can get that road fixed.
for not just our seniors at the bottom of the road, but for people that use that road on a daily and a weekly basis. So we are working with Fish and Wildlife. We are working with the Corps of Engineers. Yes, we have to work with almost everyone, and we are working with forestry to make sure that we get that fixed. Again, these are not snap your fingers, but these are things that if you work with people together, then you will get these things accomplished. There's other issues that are happening right here in our backyard. Whatever hermit is getting to the end of their cleanup process, we want to make sure that that is taken care of to the degree that they said that they were going to. And if you all know, I always call this kind of like the donut hole, that whatever hermit piece of property, that is a beautiful piece of property in Santa Clarita Valley. And so we would like that to be cleaned up to where it can be used for the residents of Santa Clarita. So we worked on the local issues, but I'm going to go a little bit further than that. When we talked about our priorities, I'm a representative in the House of Representatives. That means there are 435 of us with the Senate. There's 535 of us that work on the issues that are not just local, but the big boy issues. And I've always talked about three major issues. If you're in the Western states, if you're in Southern California, you've got to be talking about water. Water's got to be one of our top priorities at all times. At all times. I was watching the news today and they said we're going into a mega drought. And I said, you people don't live in Southern California. There is no difference between a mega drought and a drought. We're in a drought. We've been in a drought, a serious drought for 6 years. And before that, it wasn't good. So, we work on water and we work on defense of the nation. That's why I got on Armed Services. That's why I got on Science, Space, and Technology. And that's why I got on Small Business, because all of those things work together here in the Santa Clarita Valley with our DOD contractors, with our subcontractors, and with our major contractors. So, the only two campaign promises I made to you, and I don't make campaign promises, but I made two, was that we would have an office in every valley. We've done that. I would fly home every week we're in session. I've done that. Thank you very much.
And with that, we will begin our first question. As you know, real property taxes, along with other state and local taxes, are deductible on federal income taxes. In the various discussions of tax reform, limitations on these deductions have been proposed by both parties. Will either of you vote to eliminate or limit in any manner these deductions? And we'll begin the first question with Congressman Knight. No.
The American dream is to own your own house. It is. And Lily and I bought our house in 1991, and it was scary. And we're glad that we had a realtor there that could explain a lot of things to us, because we were newly married and we were trying to start our life and do all of those things. And one of the things we talked about was the deduction. The home deduction is one of those things that not just the middle class get, but everybody gets, that is very, very not just helpful, but it's something that I think that is almost owed to us. I really do. And so if we were talking about getting rid of that, that's not something that I would support. But I do think that we should streamline the tax code. I do think that there's a lot of things in the tax that are just horrible. And I'll give you a couple examples. So, if you can't fill out your taxes in an hour, not us so much, but my 22-year-old, who's just got a new job and he's trying to figure out life and all of that, and he was so confused about how to fill out his taxes, and he couldn't figure it out. And so I worked with him, and I said, you really don't have anything. You don't own anything. You've never really done a whole lot other than go to college and do all those types of things. And it's still taking a while to get through this tax process. That's not the way it should be. It should be much easier to get through your taxes. So I do support a streamlining of our taxes, and I do support bringing down our corporate tax so that we can be more competitive. Right now, a lot of corporations are leaving the country because of our corporate tax. And the second tax that I would work on, there was no doubt about it, is capital gains. Capital gains is through the roof. And if we talk about that, I know that the news always likes to say the $2 trillion that are offshore. It's more like $3.5 trillion that is offshore that could come back into our country. If that happened, it would be such an infuse of money into our economy that we would start to see more things, more access to capital. Those are the types of things that I support. But getting rid of the home owner deduction is not anything that I would be anywhere near.
Yeah, I agree with Congressman Knight on this. You know, our tax code is far too complicated, tens of thousands of pages with deductions, with credits, with all sorts of different rules that are far too complicated. And it's hard to answer in a vacuum, you know, are you going to keep this deduction or that deduction? Because in all of the different tax reform proposals that are out there, anytime you're cutting one, you're adding something else, and they really work together. But what's important to realize about the state income tax deduction is that Californians really benefit from this more than other people in other states. Because, as we all know, California has relatively high state income taxes. And so allowing us to write those off at the federal level works to our benefit as opposed to a state like Nevada where they don't have the income tax and people there aren't able to write off a state income tax deduction. So when I'm going to be considering any tax reform proposal that is put forward by anyone on either side, I'm going to make sure it isn't something that disproportionately affects the people in our state, in our community, as getting rid of any of these deductions would. And so that's the number one guiding principle I'll take with me when considering any of these proposals. I'm not going to be supporting it if we're trying to give a tax break to other states on the back of people in our community.
Jogging around here with the mic. All right, second question. Section 1031, like-kind exchanges, permits an investor in real estate to defer capital gains taxes on exchanging an investment property for another property of like-kind, which is held for investment. These transactions amount for approximately 39% of realtor sales volumes in the country and are very important for small businesses and property owners. Will you vote to continue 1031 exchanges, or do you believe the system needs to be changed? We'll begin with Mr. Caforio.
Thank you. You know, this is something that Republicans have been trying to get rid of. And so Speaker Paul Ryan, in his last proposed budget, proposed completely getting rid of 1031 exchanges. The Republican chairman of the Ways and Means Commission, Dave Camp, before him, also proposed getting rid of 1031 exchanges. I oppose that. And so what I would propose, or what I would support, is modifying the rule so that you cap the capital gains deferral at $1 million. And what this does is make it so the vast, vast majority of small businesses are going to be protected. You are able to make those 1031 exchanges as we go forward, as long as you don't have a capital gains benefit of more than $1 million in a particular year. And that is going to let the vast majority of small businesses, the vast majority of individuals, continue to take advantage of 1031 exchanges, which are so good for the economy, which lets small businesses move into a new space without worrying about whether or not they're going to be able to pay taxes on the profit. So I think it's important we keep these in place for small businesses, for individuals, but when you cap it at $1 million, you are still able to bring in $11 billion in additional revenue, and you're able to cut down on some of the abuses that some of the bigger and larger corporations use as they continually use these 1031 exchanges forever and always avoid paying those taxes. So let's protect the small businesses, let's protect the individuals, but let's make sure we keep 1031s there for them as opposed to as Paul Ryan and other Republicans have proposed. Thanks.
Well, in the state legislature, it was interesting that the realtor community came up to me and they started going through 1031s and started explaining everything to me. And they said, have you ever been involved in this? And I said, I've never been involved with it, but over the weeks and over the months, they kind of explained everything that was happening and I understood what was going on there. And then more and more professionals were coming forward to me and saying, look, this is a big part of what we do, not just here, but across the country. So we delved into it further, and I think that it shows that my record is very, very clear, that I wouldn't want to do any changes to this, because it is such a dramatic effect, not just on the realtor profession, but for our economy. So the one thing that I have found today is that answering questions for 3 minutes on something that I can say yes or no is very difficult. But we're going to keep doing that, sure. But no, my record is very clear. I support 1031 exchanges.
All right, third question is, we are continuing to collect questions and keeping them up here in the order right here. So if you have questions, please feel free to keep writing them down. And Nancy and Sunitas might be able to assist as well. Just hold your cards and grab questions. Next question. Contrary to prior Supreme Court decisions, the Obama administration has proposed to expand which water bodies are U.S. waters and therefore subject to the Clean Water Act. This would result in providing federal jurisdiction over property rights near most water bodies, not just those which are navigable. Do you believe an administration has the right to expand this power without legislative approval, and would you support the expansion as a member of Congress? And we'll begin with Congressman Knight.
So this is an issue that, and I'm not going to delve into whether President Obama has gone too far in overreach, but I will talk about the U.S. waters very, very clearly. This was a issue where it was brought in, and we're going to talk about navigable waters, and we're going to talk about tributaries. But then it started turning into farmers that had water that had gone into a ditch and had sat in the ditch for weeks, and people would come over, some bureaucracies would come over and say, these waters are part of the U.S. waters. And so we brought this to Science, Space, and Technology, where we could talk about this in an open forum. And we said, why would that be clear? And why would we not be talking about rivers and major tributaries that would have runoff that might go to the ocean or impacts like that? If a farmer is irrigating their crops and they have ditches along the side and those fill up with water, why are we talking about those? So I think the overreach came from the executive, from the president, that said, well, we are going to define these as waters under this this piece of legislation, and we're going to move forward with this. So a lot of us said, you are stifling business, you are putting regulation on an industry that is overregulated in our state and across the country. So why are we doing that? This is a constant discussion now for the last year on just this issue. So I think that there was an overreach, obviously, because I don't think that those are tributaries, and I don't think that those feed to the ocean, or they hurt what we're trying to do, and that is make sure that we have safe drinking water and we have safe waters that go to the ocean. I do think that this is an overreach.
So this issue can really be traced back to 2006. There was a Supreme Court opinion, the Rapinos case, and it was a 4-4-1 decision, and the one, Justice Kennedy, was the decider, who said that an administration had authority to, under the Clean Water Act, in situations where there is a, quote, significant nexus to navigable waters. Well, that's an inherently vague term. And so what that led to then was a flood of litigation over the last 10 years of trying to determine, is this a significant nexus to navigable waters? Is this a significant nexus? Is it only water that is constantly flowing to a navigable water? Is it, if it comes twice a year when there's a flood, is that a nexus? And that really all stems back to these relying on one person who's unelected on a court to put two vague terms in an opinion that we then go off of. And so I don't tend to look at, you know, a particular ruling or executive order from the administration or regulation and whether I agree with that or not in determining if they have overreached or gone far enough, because I think it's easy to get trapped into, oh, I like this policy, I don't like this policy, but you want to be able to be consistent with the next president, whether President Trump or Clinton, who you might have not trust as much to make a decision, or you might trust more. And so what this really comes down to is a failure of Congress to pass a law that has clear enough legislation so that we aren't relying on a two-word vague term from a single person on the Supreme Court to determine what the executive is able to do. Let's have our representatives in Washington put forward a clear piece of legislation that is going to outline specifically what we are including in the Clean Water Act or the Clean Water Act as it would be amended, instead of simply relying on this unelected judge to put those terms out there and the flood of litigation that comes thereafter. Thank you.
All right, fourth question. The chamber supports a pro-growth tax plan, which would lower tax rates for businesses and individuals, along with simplifying compliance and administration. Currently, the U.S. business tax rate is the highest in the industrial world, and our current system also has a bias against capital investment. What is your position on these proposals? And we'll begin with Mr. Caporio.
Thank you. Our corporate tax system is broken, and this part of what you know, led me to run for Congress, seeing the misplaced priorities, seeing the dysfunction in Washington, where they are truly looking out only for the biggest banks and biggest corporations, and they have all these loopholes in there that are hurting people back home. And so what I support for corporate taxes is a formulary apportionment procedure. And what that would do is tax companies based on their sales in the United States. Right now we tax on assets, we tax on payroll. That incentivizes companies to shift their headquarters overseas, to ship their manufacturing jobs overseas where they don't get taxed on the assets or the payroll, and then they, you know, they park their intellectual property in Northern Ireland or another tax haven and claim they made profit in another country, not in the United States. If we transition to the formulary apportionment model and we say, we're not going to punish you for having assets in America. We're not going to punish you for having payroll in America. We are only going to tax you for your sales in the United States. So if company XYZ has $10 million of sales in worldwide sales of TVs in a year, and 50% of those TVs are sold in the United States to United States consumers, then they pay their, you know, taxes on their 50% of their profits in the United States. And it doesn't matter if they have their headquarters in Japan or in Mexico or in Santa Clarita. And what this does is really benefit our small businesses, because our domestic corporations right now have a competitive disadvantage against multinational and foreign companies who don't have to pay the same taxes, and they are claiming that they made profits elsewhere, even for those sales in the United States. So if we transition to this, we will be able to lower our corporate tax rates for everybody, because we will be capturing taxes from these multinationals and these foreign companies who are currently selling to U.S. consumers but not paying taxes in the United States. This will really help our small businesses and make sure that we are giving domestic companies an advantage over foreign multinationals. Thank you.
It's simple. I support a slimmer tax code, and I support lowering our taxes. And I firmly believe that if we do that, we can get an infusion of money back into this country. We can get more interest in our companies to invest here. That's why we brought up a bill when I was in the legislature. I authored it. Upbringing headquarters right here in California. Because I do believe if you have the headquarters here, you are more invested. So I'm glad that we agree on that, because I do believe that the headquarters is the big part. But let's take this one step further. it's not just the corporate tax, it's everything that's happening. So when you're a state legislator, you look at what is our competition? Well, our competition here in California might be Arizona, might be Nevada, might be a number of other states around here, but it's also the Pacific Rim, it's also other countries. This state is the sixth biggest economy in the world if we were a country on our own. So we have to look at different things. So if you're in the House of Representatives or in the Senate, you have to look at what is our competition. Well, right now we have the highest corporate tax. So that puts us at a competitive disadvantage. When I got elected, I said, the one thing I'm not going to ever do is vote for stuff that puts us at competitive disadvantages for either our business or our people. Because that's the most important for our people to thrive, is we've got to be competitively advantaged, or at least on the same level. The corporate tax has to come down. It has to. I don't know anyone who thinks that the corporate tax being so high and being so much higher than the other industrialized nations is a good thing for us. We have to slim the tax code, and the corporate tax has to come down.
All right, final prepared question. The United States has a debt problem which threatens our fiscal health. By 2050, unless something is done, interest costs on the debt are projected to be 4 times what the federal government has historically spent on education, scientific research and development, and infrastructure combined. Entitlement programs are the driver of the spending increase. Between 2014 and 2025, the Congressional Budget Office projects that total spending on entitlement will increase by $1.7 trillion, and neither Social Security or Medicare are projected to be financially solvent 20 years from now, while Medicaid is impacting state budgets. How would you put entitlement programs on a sustainable path by making reasonable changes and gradually phasing reforms to slow the rate of growth? And we'll begin with Congressman Knight.
So there's 3 things that I talk about. I think my wife says you talk about these too much, but it is debt, deficit, defense. So the 3 D's are the issues that can bring down our country. They really are. The debt is now about $19.5 trillion. Our deficit is $590 billion. And we spend about $607 billion on defense. In about 6 years, we're going to spend more on payment of our debt than we do defending this nation. So those things should be sobering facts. And for all of you who don't know what $19.5 trillion is, if I did this every second, and every time I did that, it was a dollar, it would take me 627,000 years to pay off our debt. So that's pretty much figuring out how much the debt is. When I say that to my fifth graders, they all look at me like, and I say, well, in a couple of years, you're going to really figure out how big that is. So there's nothing bigger than debt, deficit, defense for our nation. The mandatory spending every year is about 68-69% right now. That happens. If we pass a budget right now, if the House passes a budget, it'll be a little over $1 trillion, about $1.7 trillion. $1.07 trillion is going to be about our budget, but we're going to spend about $4 trillion. So about 69% of that is just going to happen. This is growing. It's continuing to grow. Once that gets to about 90%, just think of that as your own budget in your own house. If you have such a big credit card bill, but you had a lot of extra money coming in that you could pay down your credit card, you could probably maintain. But once you get to about 90% and you only have 10% of discretionary money, that credit card bill now overtakes you. And so that's what we're looking at, is when these types of things will happen. Social Security and Medicare are extremely important, not just to our seniors today, but for the future. If we don't talk about them today, we just let it go and say, well, everything will be okay, we will have problems. In our generation, the nonpartisan study that comes out every year says right around 2035 is when we're going to have major problems with this. Major problem means for all of you who are on Social Security, instead of getting $1,000, next month you'll get $700. So those are the major problems. If we don't talk about them on a daily basis and just say everything will be okay, it won't. We've got to fix these problems. So I think that the discretionary spending has either got to be able to be looked at and helped and maintained, or we are going to get to where that 69% gets too high and it's going to overtake us.
You know, I firmly believe we need to take steps now in Washington to strengthen and secure both Social Security and Medicare to make sure that we are fulfilling that sacred promise for decades to come. So Social Security, this is a program that before it was implemented, 78% of seniors, the year before it was implemented, 78% of seniors were in poverty. Today, it's less than 10%. This is a great program, and it's lifted tens of millions of people out of poverty so they can live out their years in dignity and respect. But we need to make sure it's still there. And so if we make some slight changes, if we lift the payroll tax cap right now, which would only affect at most 7% of people, the CBO estimates that we can fully fund this, completely fund it for at least another 60 years. That's an easy change that we can make right now and guarantee that it is still available for every person in this room here. With regards to Medicare, you know, this is again a wonderful program that does so much good for so many Americans, and there are some real easy changes we could make if our Washington politicians were not beholden to special interest. So one change right off the bat, if you make Medicare, or if you treat people who are duly eligible under Medicare and Medicare Advantage, and you pay them at the same rate instead of paying more under Medicare Advantage as we do now for the exact same treatment, it would save $150 billion over 10 years. If we require drug manufacturers to provide drug rebates for people who are duly eligible under Medicare and Medicaid, it would save $141 billion over 10 years. And if we would allow the government to negotiate for drug prices, it would save between $150 and $500 billion over 10 years. We could implement those three policies in a month if we had elected officials in Washington who were not so beholden on their donations from those companies who have a vested interest in charging us too much. And those three changes would save between $500 billion and $1 trillion over 10 years. And we could make those changes right now. Thank you.
All right, thank you. That concludes our first section of prepared questions. We're now going to move on to audience questions. As a reminder, your questions must be policy issue based related. Statements, positions, or questions deemed as an attack on the candidates will be skipped, or I will see if I can't moderate them a little bit. Each candidate's going to have 3 minutes to respond. We're going to begin with Mr. Caforio. And the first question we have is, with the goal of reducing federal spending, should one, the budget of the Veterans Administration be reduced, and two, the budget of NASA be reduced?
No and no. You know, first off, with our veterans. When you have served and sacrificed for this country, we need to make absolutely certain that we are there for you when you come back. And it is absolutely outrageous when we see elected officials in Washington failing to live up to that standard, failing to take care of our veterans. What I hate to see, and it's so frustrating, is when you go to a baseball game and they have a veteran stand up and everyone applauds and they talk about how much they care about veterans, but then you look at how they vote in Washington and you see they're not actually living up to that standard. And so just a few months ago, we had Republicans in Congress who voted to cut the post 9/11 GI Bill. I think that's outrageous. I have pledged to defend the post 9/11 GI Bill because I am going to make absolutely certain that we are fully funding the programs our veterans need. We are making sure that we are providing education when they come back, job training programs when they come back, and of course, health care, both physical and mental, so that they are able to fully transition back into civilian life. And I will not be voting to cut any of the care or services that we give to our veterans. With regards to NASA, No, I don't support cutting this. We have a NASA facility here in this district up in the Antelope Valley. They run the SOFIA program there, just had a wonderful tour of that facility and seen the great work they're doing, particularly with regards to climate change, which is such a great threat facing us all right now. And it provides 600 jobs in our area as they continue for decades. This facility has gotten funding, has spurred our economy, has conducted cutting-edge research in aeronautics to make sure that we continue building things here. We continue studying things here. We have such great weather and such great space in the 25th District for this cutting-edge research that we need to make sure we fund NASA and we fight to make sure that NASA funding comes home to us in the 25th District. Thank you.
Should have saved some time for this one. The VA, no. But here's what the VA's got to do. The administration has lost their track a little bit. So since about 1975, since we left the Vietnam War, there's been a change in the VA. And we've got to evolve. In other words, we don't need a whole lot more VA hospitals. We don't need more VA clinics. What we need is public-private partnerships. So if we need a hospital right here, why wouldn't we have a hospital that connects to our citizens and connects to our veterans? We could have a veterans wing, or we could have a veterans hospital right here that serves our community. But right now we're building a hospital in Denver that's going to cost us about $1.7 billion. It should have cost about $700 million. What we had to do in Congress was pass a bill so we could fire people in the VA. That is ludicrous to me. If you are failing at your job miserably, then you should probably be fired. But no, we had to do that in Congress. So the VA has lost its way, not the people in the VA, not the clinicians, not the nurses, not the doctors. They know. But the administration has lost their way, and we've got to get them back on track. Now, the second part about the VA, if people start talking about, hey, well, the way to fix the VA is to do, more clinics in your thing and more hospitals and all of that, please don't listen to them. That is not the way the VA needs to go. The public-private partnership is the way the VA will go in the future. We will still use the VA facilities. We'll still use the great facility in Wisconsin where they do transplants. We will still use the facilities down here in Southern California. But moving forward, we should have a much closer connection to the community. NASA is very easy for me. I just sent a letter to the chairman and the ranking member saying that NASA should be fully funded this year. I'll send that letter every year, I'm sure. We created the Aeronautics Innovation Act this last year, and as long as I'm in Congress, we're going to push this until it is law. Basically what it is a roadmap. A roadmap for our commitment as people to do things that are going to be bigger than us. And in my roadmap, we have a low-boom supersonic demonstrator. That means if an airplane's flying over right now 30,000 feet, over Mach 1, you're going to have a big boom. It's going to rattle your glasses. With a low-boom supersonic demonstrator, it'll do that, and you'll never know. So once that happens, we're going to be flying across the country in 2 hours. That is a big advantage for us, technology, for business, for tourism, for everything. Second thing is hypersonics. Bringing a new hypersonic program that goes over 4,000 miles an hour to us so that we can have more economical ways to space. We can have more economical ways that we can move goods. So this is just part of the Innovation Act, but yes, don't lower the money.
Next question from the audience is, any ideas on housing affordability in our area as well as our country? We'll begin with Congressman Knight.
Yeah, so housing affordability, the very first thing on housing affordability is jobs. It is. That is the connection to housing affordability on the first step. The second step is we've got a lot of things that happen here in Southern California that are regulated by our RENA requirements, by SCAG, by all of these types of things that we have to do requirements here at the local level. Santa Clarita is a pretty good economical scale, and your housing is pretty good. If you go just 40 miles on almost any direction from here, the houses go down a little bit. If you go up to the north, obviously the housing crisis is a little lower than it is here, and quite a bit lower when you go a little bit north from there. But jobs are the main thing, good paying jobs. So what we have struggled in this district is we get an awful lot of really good jobs, but we get an awful lot of jobs that are paying, you know, those $9, $10, $11 an hour. You're not going to buy a house in Santa Clarita for $11 an hour. So jobs is the very first part. The second part on affordable housing is people have to have access to affordable housing. They have to have access to be able to get into a home or to get into a place that obviously they can afford. And the third part is our homeless population. And people don't talk about this too much on affordable housing, but our homeless population is a part of that discussion. It really is, because there is a lot of different groups in our homeless population, but one of the groups is people that have found themselves homeless, that are educated, that are skilled, that can get work, and they have either by bad luck or bad circumstance found themselves homeless. So all three of those things have got to be worked on. But understand also, when we're talking about affordable housing, we're talking about affordable housing for the area. Affordable housing for this area is going to be a little bit higher than some other areas. But that is always going to be one of the issues that we always work on. I put this in a group of a huge amount of issues. Homelessness, crime, affordable housing, access to clean water, all of those types of things are going to be always something that we work on, always something that we can do better at, and elect people that are working.
It's important that we have, you know, policies in place that are working to incentivize communities, developers, to provide affordable housing whenever possible. And there's a lot that can be done at the federal level, but also at the state and local level to make sure you're giving incentives to developers when they are building homes. If you make, you know, X percentage that are going to be affordable housing, you get this benefit. You can also do that with regards to, you know, climate change is something I care deeply about. And it's something that we have a lot of opportunity here in the 25th District in order to really be a leader in the clean energy economy that's coming forward. And one part of that can be building more energy efficient homes that are smaller, that take up less space, that are more affordable. And so if you put policies in place that incentivize building some of those developments, it's not only great for our community, great for our planet as we go forward. It not only will create jobs as you do it, but it will also help bring some more affordable housing to whatever area you start implementing these policies. And so we need to make absolutely certain that when we build and develop, we are considering whatever options we have to put aside some percentage for affordable housing so that we can make sure everyone in our community is able to stay in our community and continue being a part of that community.
So this question has to do with minimum wage. Since the minimum wage has been increased to $15 in Seattle, there has also been increased unemployment rate. Do you fear that happening in California? And we'll begin with Mr. Caporio.
Thank you. I support the minimum wage increase at a federal level. I think that it is outrageous that we have so many people who I talk to who are working two jobs to get by, who are living in poverty even while they're working more than 40 hours a week. That's wrong. And California has now taken the step to raise our minimum wage to $15. And regardless of what we do at the federal level, it is going to be a $15 minimum wage here in California. And so, as you know, Congressman Knight talked about earlier today, that when he's looking at how to vote on policy, he wants to make sure he's not putting Californians at a competitive disadvantage. Well, this is one of those situations where I would like to see him then champion a federal minimum wage increase. Because right now, California is moving to $15. Every business in our community is going to have to pay a minimum wage of $15 an hour. And so if you go to Washington and you vote against a federal minimum wage increase, that means you are letting other states, other small businesses who are competing against California companies, pay their employees less. You are putting California employers at a competitive disadvantage unless you go to Washington and support a federal minimum wage increase. And so I support it, not just because it is the right thing to do to give people a fair wage for a fair day's work, but now that it's already happened in California, we need to be looking out for our community and the businesses in our community. And a good way to do that is make sure we're not competitively disadvantaged by voting for a benefit to other states that won't help our businesses here.
So $15 an hour is a big jump. It is. I don't know that it's a fair wage for a fair day's work, but it is a big jump. And minimum wage has to move. It does. It's not going to stay at a quarter of an hour like it was at some point. It's not going to be at $3 an hour like when I got my first job. It does have to move. But it has to be in a commensurate to the ability to have the economy move. So I'll give you a couple examples. Back in the 50s and 60s, the automotive industry was revolutionized with robotics, with things that took away jobs, that made things that now machinery was doing, that, you know, jobs were, or men and women were doing just before that. The aerospace industry went through this with computers. Today is the first time that I can ever see that technology can take some of our minimum wage jobs away. And I guarantee each and every one of us has seen that just this week. You've walked into a grocery store, you've walked into one of our home improvement stores, and you've seen the self-checker. Well, the self-checker was a cashier and a bagger, but now is a machine. Technology can take away some of our minimum wage jobs. So that is the step, that if we take that step too far, then just understand that business will figure out a way that they can get around some of these issues. If I pay you, I gotta pay you an hourly wage, I have to pay you workman's compensation, I might have to pay into a whole litany of other things, medical, pensions, all kinds of things. If I buy a machine, I have to do nothing. I have to service that machine once a year, okay? So understand, if we take a jump too far, businesses will start to grab these machines. And I'll just give you one last example. There's a company out there that's figuring out how to collect all the SKUs when they're in bags. So you go in there with your bags, you bag your groceries, you put them into your cart, and it goes over a strip on the floor, and it attacks all the SKUs, it grabs the SKUs, it says you owe $76, you put in your card, and you leave. You will never see anyone in a grocery store again, except for a stalker, not the stalkers on me, nightly stalkers that are stalking the goods in there. So we have to be very careful when we're talking about minimum wage, and we should always have the business community come in on these discussions. It shouldn't be politicians, like happened in Sacramento, that he picked $9 and he picked $10. And when I asked him, he said, well, it's logical, isn't it? I said, no, it's not logical. How'd you pick 9 and 10? He said, well, those are round numbers. So that's what a politician did, to pick $9 and $10 for California.
Next question has to do with immigration. I've kind of reformatted this question, just tapping at the heart of it. But what is your position on immigration reform, specifically dealing with people who are here and those who are working to come through the system? We'll begin with Congressman Knight.
Immigration reform. We have to have a policy that works. We have to. So right now it doesn't work. It doesn't work for people who come here legally. It doesn't work for people who come over the border looking for a better life. And the policy is so askew that it only takes an attorney that is in that field to get paid $3,000 or $5,000 or $10,000 that these people don't have. They don't have $3, $5, or $10, but then they have to leverage themselves to pay an attorney to maybe get through the system. So here's what I say. And I'm pretty well versed on this because my wife came here from Chile, and she came here legally, and we went through the whole process, the legal process. And I've brought this up before. We slept on the nights of the immigration steps, two nights in a row, with our pillows and our blankets, because you have to be like about 50 people in line, 50 legal residents in line that they would take you each day. And so at that point I said, well, this isn't right. It isn't right for people that are coming here illegally. But there's also a lot of people that are coming over here illegally and they're looking for a better life. So if we're gonna have a policy that's so convoluted and you have to hire an attorney to do this, that's not a policy that works. First thing, we have to have better border security. We do. It is too porous, and I can guarantee you, as your representative in the House of Representatives, if somebody comes over the border right now and does a terrorist act in this country, you're going to look at me and say, why weren't you talking about border security? That is the number one reason why we talk about border security. Because some people want to come over here and do bad things to us. They're not just looking for a job or a better way of life. The second thing, we have an industry here in America that we have to talk about, and it is the agriculture industry. We have to talk about that, so we have to sit down after all the politics are over and after all the garbage is done, and talk about a policy that will work for agriculture. And I support that. We should be working with immigration. We should be figuring this out. This isn't that hard of a deal, but politics get involved, and then everybody starts to get into their own little hole. We gotta figure this out. There are about 12 million people in this country that are here illegally, and we've gotta talk about that issue. But we've gotta work on the agriculture issue, the very first thing. A lot of people bring up the hotels and restaurants and things like that, but agriculture is number one. So I know that politics brings into immigration. It shouldn't. We should just figure this out and make it so people can have a life. People can immigrate to this country through a process, and it shouldn't be that hard.
And just so you know, we have enough questions up here to last us through the weekend, so just sort of doing as best as possible. And there are some duplicate type questions, so we're trying to combine those up here. Next question is regarding the Obama administration's policy on ISIS and dealing with the war on ISIS in the Middle East. Has it been sufficient, and what is your position? And we'll begin with Mr. Kapari.
Brought it out on defense of the nation. I know that ISIS is the question, but I'm going to broaden it to a lot of different areas where our defense of our nation is impacted. So, we got the most serious attack 15 years ago on our borders, inside our country. It changed things. I think it changed the way we think. It did change our lives a little bit. Now we go through metal detectors at airports. Now we have a little bit different life, but it hasn't changed us. That fight is very easy for them. The internet makes it very easy to recruit and very easy to get young minds to think about something that they wouldn't have thought about, but now they're kind of pushing them. So what we have tried to do, especially in armed services, is make sure that when we're fighting our enemy, when we're fighting ISIS, or we're fighting other fronts, and there are many fronts that are happening across the world right now, that we make sure that we talk to the military and we ask the military, what do you need? If you need this, then we want to put it into the National Defense Authorization Act. If we're going to spend $610 billion funding our military, we want to make sure that they have the best stuff and they're trained the best. Because in my opinion, we should fight fair. And that's what the National Defense Authorization Act should always be about. So the Navy came to me last year and said, our ISR needs to be bumped up. We need more Tritons. Put in three Tritons into the National Defense Authorization Act. We make them here in this district, and we fly them right outside the district. They're stationed at Naval Air Station Ventura. So those are the kinds of things that we will do. We'll continue to work with the military. I get briefings all the time to understand what's happening around the world, what's happening in Syria today, what's happening with Russia's involvement, what's happening with Russia's new movement of missiles into the area. So we get these types of briefings, but it's always talking to the military, what do you need? And the first thing they always say is, make sure when we send somebody to battle, they know what they're doing. They're trained, and we're not sending somebody that is not ready. So reliability and readiness is always going to be one of our top issues. But the National Defense Authorization Act, that's why I want armed services. This is my number one pick. That's why I said, hey, look, I want to be there talking about these decisions, not just for the district, but for our country and for our nation. So of all the things that are happening from North Korea all the way across, we talk about these on a daily basis.
And we've got time for one final question here. We all need to closing statements. And this is a kind of a repeat question that's come up here a few times, but how do we improve stability and collaboration in our national democracy in Washington to move beneficial programs forward? And we'll begin with Congressman Knighton.
I'm going to say something that probably no other politician will say. We get some things done in Washington. You get some things done in Sacramento. It doesn't always come out, and you don't always get that. But we changed the retirement for the military last year. I talk to veterans groups all the time, and the veterans groups are looking at me like, what do you mean? We did. So now, when I enlisted at 18 years old, and I came out of the Army, I had certain benefits that were mine. I could get a VA loan, I could go to the VA, I could do certain things. But when I went to college, I was behind my peers. They had already gone either through college or most of the way through college. And I had served my country, which is one of the biggest moments of my life. But what we did last year is we said, we're gonna build a thrift savings plan for you. So if you go in there and you're an E1 or you're an O1, you will have a thrift savings plan going with you. So now if you leave the military at 4 years or 14 years, you will still have that thrift savings plan that goes with you, much like certain businesses and corporations that have 401ks or 457bs or thrift savings plans. And so we got them online to say, now you've served your country, but you also take this with you. So now when you go out to work, you've got this thrift savings plan that you roll over and you can do things like that. So that was kind of the very first thing that we did. There's nothing more important to me than making sure that our military is ready and making sure that we have the right things for them. But some of the problems that we're seeing today, and they're partisan issues. They're very partisan issues. But every day in Congress, we seem to get things done that don't hit the news or don't hit the media, or they report them on the third to last page. And I think, golly, we just passed that bill. We passed one for cybersecurity just a few weeks ago to talk about the things that Mr. Caforio was talking about. We did that in a bipartisan measure that we went in there and we said, we're going to work with these companies like Google, like some of these top companies that have these really intricate kind of connections to internet security. And we're going to work with them, and we're going to share information. We did that. And yet, nothing gets reported, and everyone says, well, Washington is broken, and all those people don't know what the heck they're doing. Well, yeah, for some reason, you're right. But we do get things done, and it's a collaboration with Republicans and with Democrats. And I've always done that. I mean, I was in the super minority in Sacramento, and I passed more legislation than any other Republican in the Senate. It's because I don't care. If it's a good idea, it's a good idea. Let's talk about the good idea. Let's work on the good idea. Let's get something done. Well, thank you all for coming out this morning. Thank you to the chamber. Well, I've never been beat up so bad in my life over the last 35 days. I agree. This dark money is killing me. But let's set the record straight. We talked about small business, we talked about veterans, we talked about the aerospace community. Let's talk about my bills, about what we've brought forward. No Hero Left Untreated Act. That is a new therapy that will help our warriors that are coming home with PTS and TBI. It'll also help with traumatic sexual attacks. So that affects our veteran community, affects our VA community, and we're pushing that through very quickly. Our very first bill was on small business, connected to aerospace. The second bill is small business connected to aerospace. It's in the National Defense Authorization Act. When we go back and lame duck, we're going to pass that NDAA. We're going to pass another bill signed by President Obama. The third thing that we talked about was the Aeronautics Innovation Act. Aerospace, good paying jobs, bringing jobs in and making sure that our economy continues these good paying jobs. When I was in the Senate, I was the author, and a lot of other people say things about this. I was the author of the B-21 prime contractor. That means that we could have the B-21 here. That happened. Northrop got the contract. It's going to be built up in Palmdale. Hopefully it'll roll out of Palmdale. They're going to build it in Palmdale and Florida. It'll bring about 3,500 jobs to Southern California, not just to Palmdale, to Southern California, good paying jobs averaging $93,000 a year. Those are the things I told you we would work on. That's what we've worked on. I don't get into a lot of politics. Some people say, well, you gotta do this, gotta do that. I don't get into a lot of politics. I get into problem solving. We do what we say, and we say what we do. And that's what we've done. That's what we'll continue to do as long as I'm in this office. Won't get involved in all the other garbage that happens, but we will continue to reach out to the community. Last thing, we've done 17 town halls, fellow town halls, and we've done about 10 round tables. The last round table was on access to capital for women-owned businesses, minority-owned businesses, and disadvantaged-owned businesses. That connects to what we're doing in small business, because that's what we believe in. So last, I want to thank my wife for always being next to me, and you, the community, because there's no community in the world I would represent except the 25th District. Thank you.